Recorded Books presents 1,000 Texas Longhorns by Johnny D. Boggs, narrated by Graham Winton. From Larry McMurtry, Lonesome Dove. "Live through it," Call said. "That's all we can do." Part 1. Winter. Chapter 1. The first thing he noticed were the trees. Not a leaf, not a branch, not a twig, and nary a pine needle in sight. Nothing. This high up in the Rockies, with plenty of water, Virginia City, Montana Territory, should have been lumber rich. But Mason Boone turned his head and spit. Log cabins dotted the hills, and wooden frame buildings lined the main street, with some picket, board and batten, and clabbered shacks mixed among a few stone structures. Wood had to be around here somewhere. Smoke puffed out of brick chimneys and iron pipes, and Boone smelled wood smoke, not coal. Boone stepped out of the way as a mule-drawn wagon headed toward Nevada City. Wooden wagon, too. The driver didn't look altogether friendly, and his blue overcoat reminded Boone of damn Yankees. Boone looked in every direction. Not even a shade tree. That didn't matter, because there wasn't any sun here either. Just dark clouds, closer to the ground than they ought to be. But although Virginia City sat in a bowl, the elevation topped 5,000 feet. For the time being, the only snow could be found in the shady parts, caused by the buildings, or in the dirty piles shoveled off walkways and boardwalks, or swept over any flat-roofed structure. Boone figured his toes had frozen solid after trudging through drifts on his hike here. Around the city, clouds, threatening more snow, obscured peaks of most of the surrounding mountains. "One tree. That's all I want. Just one tree. Just to sit under, rest my feet, scratch my back." Another wagon driver hollered at Boone to get the hell out of the road. "Right around me." Boone's tone and eyes must have warned that cackler that Mason Boone wasn't one to trifle with. Boone looked down one boardwalk, if anybody would actually call those planks a boardwalk, and across the street. Over the rooftops at the hills, nary a tree. Maybe higher up, behind or above the gray clouds, but not here. Virginia City, Mason Boone figured, might as well be in Kansas.
"Pies. Fresh baked pies."
Discovering the source of the voice, Boone forgot all about trees. What in God's name had gotten into him? Trees? He was no lumberjack, no carpenter, could barely tell the difference between a sweet gum and an aspen. It might have had something to do with that dream from the past night. Another one of those he barely remembered, like most of his dreams, the rare times he ever dreamed. But more than likely, this preoccupation with trees could be attributed to walking from a piss-poor claim in the gravelly range all the way to Virginia City. His feet hurt. Not enough left of his socks to darn. Holes in both boots, if you could call them boots. If some quinine Jimmy told him that his nose was frostbit and had to be cut off, Boone wouldn't have cared. He didn't even stop to look at the wares in the window of the mechanical bakery. He forgot about how much his feet hurt. He forgot about trees. He walked, picking up the pace, when the woman with the pies turned down another street. Boone didn't catch up with her until she stood in front of the planter's house. His focus trained so hard on the raven-haired woman hawking pies, he didn't even notice the sign above the building on the other side of the street. Barnard Slavin and Company. At the Liquor Emporium, pure rye and bourbon whiskey. Brandy, gin, rum, Stoughton and plantation bitters, port wine, claret wine, Heidsick champagne, sparkling Catawba, carbon oil, etc., 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 etc. She saw him, though, yet didn't step back, even though Boone knew he stunk to high heaven. His nose might have been frozen by the wind, but he could smell. Yet penetrating his stench came the delectable aromas of delicacies that had eluded him at that boar's nest where he had been mining. He hadn't seen a woman since Easter.
Mayo?
He managed.
Would you like a pie?
The voice might have been guarded and the eyes colder than the wind, but she managed to smile. At least Boone convinced himself she smiled. He stared without blinking.
Mayo?
This time, many seconds later, it came out as a question.
A pie? She said. Dried apple today. That's all we have.
Dried apple?
He repeated, which came out as if he were speaking blackfeet. Black hair, parted at the middle. Dark eyes, round face. Coat of winter wool. He saw the tray she carried, pies with golden crusts, lined in a row. Four pies. Not very big, but deep dish. From the vacant spots, she must have already sold nine.
Would you like a pie, sir?
His eyes came up again. A horse hitched in front of a business up Jackson Street began to urinate. Boone found his voice.
How much?
His right hand reached into the pocket in his denim breeches.
$5.
He stopped reaching. His hand had gone through the big rip and his fingernails began scratching his thigh. He had used the remnants of his underdrawers the previous night to get a fire going. Boone stared.
$5?
She didn't debate him.
For a puny pie? He thought.
Fellow came all this way, nigh 2,000 miles, most of that on the Ankle Express. Well, Boone figured a man who traveled that far, he deserved a pie. But nobody ever charged $5 for a pie back in Texas or Tennessee. Besides, Boone didn't have 5 cents. Hadn't seen a dollar in a coon's age.
$5?
He stopped scratching his leg, removed his hand from the pocket, stared at his fingernails, noticed the filth. He also saw people stepping out of the planter's house, and even more from the building across the street. That's when he finally saw the sign. All of a sudden, he felt real thirsty.
$5, the raven-haired beauty spoke again. Maybe you'll have sufficient funds tomorrow.
She moved back toward Wallace Street. The men in front of the liquor emporium laughed. Later, Boone figured, he must have gone crazy. All those months on the Ruby, all that hard work, for nothing. The long walk to Virginia City, not to mention all the miles he had traveled just to get here. Sure, that'd be more than enough to drive a fellow loco. Mason Boone wasn't the kind of man who'd let some walking whiskey vats drive him to do something stupid. Then again, later, when his brain became less addled, he would also remember that folks back in Smith County had said Mason Boone wasn't the type of man who'd quit his country and desert. The pie-selling angel stopped when Boone caught up with her.
Yes.
There was no warmth in her voice, no humor in those deep, dark eyes. He noticed a slight scar above an eyebrow, wondered how she had gotten it. Laughter from the far boardwalk reached him. Mason Boone smiled.
Maybe, he said, we could work out a trade.
The eyes didn't blink. His face suddenly warmed, and he knew why. Damn it all to hell if he hadn't blushed. The woman should be blushing, or turning red with rage, but it was Boone who felt embarrassed. And now the laughter across the street angered him. And if he hadn't been so captured by those dark eyes, he would have charged across the street like he had charged at Missionary Ridge. Instead, he just looked into eyes like the darkest, deepest mine. He hated himself. A kaleidoscope of colors replaced the beautifully shaped face. The pain blinded him, shooting from the top of his head to his toes. Someone had to be screaming. And blood ran between his fingers as Boone tried to squeeze the split in his skull back together. Maybe Boone let the oaths fly. If anyone still laughed, the roaring in Boone's ears drowned out that noise. He thought he had drawn his legs up, smelled the mixture of manure and gravel in the dirt, felt as though he had rolled himself up into a ball. He prayed that he hadn't messed his britches. He swallowed snot. He tasted blood. For a brief moment, he remembered Kennesaw Mountain and beginning that long, stupid walk. Then he pictured the pine trees,
He even saw his ma and pretty Janice Terry, and smelled the scent of pine trees, pine sap, and felt the warmth of a fireplace back home in Tyler. Folks up here in Alder Gulch thought Texas was just like Kansas and Wyoming, some flat, treeless plain. They'd never seen the piney woods. Boone wished he had never left. He heard that woman's voice. "Nelson, don't!" The last word came out as a scream. Just before Boone disappeared into blackness, darker than that pie seller's eyes. Chapter 2. Dried apple pies toppled onto the boardwalk and streets. 4 of them ruined, $20 worth of baking lost. But Ellen's story could not, would not think about that. She let the tray she had fashioned rattle on the stones, brushed past her husband, and knelt by the stinking, bearded young man who clutched his bleeding head. His hat, if one could call it a hat, rolled over toward the groggery. His hands turned crimson before they slipped from that fine dark hair. His eyes fluttered, eventually rolling up and out of sight, and he let out a heavy sigh.
"Get up, Ellen. And you best go about your business."
Looking up, he found her husband pointing the Navy Colt's barrel at the men lounging in front of the liquor emporium's entrance. They must have stepped out from their afternoon of idleness to witness the fun. Most of them disappeared for more drinking, but 2 moved down the street toward hobbled horses. Even the men standing in front of the planter's house began to find safer climbs.
"Ellen, I said get up."
There he stood, king of the world. Times like this, she wondered what she'd ever seen in him back in Leavenworth, Kansas. Well, that wasn't quite the truth. She knew exactly what she'd seen in Nelson Guile's story. About an inch under 6 feet tall, nigh 200 pounds, with blonde hair and blue-gray eyes. He wasn't hard on the eyes like most of her would-be Jayhawker suitors.
"Got a head for business," Pod told her. "And the Midas touch," said her older brother John.
Nelson's story worked hard. Of that she had no uncertainty. Any man who hauled wood for her father couldn't fear calluses or be allergic to sweat. Back then, eastern Kansas, spitting distance from Missouri, could be the devil on courtships. Nelson's story came from Ohio. The Trents started off in Kentucky before Ellen's pa moved to Platte County, Missouri, when John was a youngster. Ellen was Missouri-born, but Pa moved the family to Kansas Territory in 54, so when it came time to vote for statehood, the more Kentuckians and Virginians casting ballots, Ma explained later, the better chance Kansas could become a slave state. Well, that hadn't worked out, but Pa never had been the luckiest or smartest man Ellen had known. Nelson's story, on the other hand, was something else. So her father decided to forget about his southern leanings, democratic tendencies, and that forlorn hope of becoming rich enough to own a bevy of slaves. In those years, Ellen rarely saw this side of Nelson's story, though a few gossips let stories slip out about him knifing a neighbor's forearm up in Ohio, beating a man half to death in Monticello Township, using a colt to buffalo a drunkard in Liberty, much as he had just done to this poor fellow.
"Ellen, I won't tell you."
"Shut your mouth, Nelson."
Her black eyes burned. Her husband blinked.
"Hand me your bandana."
First, he pouted, started to say something else, thought better of that mistake, and finally slid the Navy into the holster on his left hip. Another 36 remained holstered on the right hip.
"For balance,"
Thomas Dimsdale, editor of the Montana Post, often joked. Montana wind would spin Nelson like a top if he didn't carry 2 revolvers. She took the piece of frayed calico and pressed it against the man's head, trying to be gentle, yet hard enough to stanch the flowing blood. A wave of nausea struck her, and she hated herself for this. Her husband despised weakness, but closing her eyes, she drew in a deep breath, held it as long as she could, and hoped she wouldn't throw up black tea and fresh biscuits onto this poor man. When her eyes opened, Nelson Story squatted beside her, his hand out, eyes maybe a tad softer now.
"Here," he said, "I'll do it."
Their gaze is locked.
It's my bandana, Ellen, Nelson said.
Without waiting, he moved his right hand down and pressed the rag tighter on the man's wound. Withdrawing her hand, Ellen looked away from the stranger, but the wreckage of her morning's baking made her sob.
Oh.
She hadn't meant to say anything. Nelson Story glanced at the busted pies.
It's all right, he said.
No, it's not.
Not in a town like Virginia City, Idaho Territory.
No. It was Montana territory now, since the federal government had carved Montana out of Idaho and who knows what other territories. She still had trouble remembering that they now lived in Montana territory, not Idaho territory. But Nelson always told her it didn't matter the name. Hell was hell, no matter who claimed it.
Ellen had been selling pies since they had arrived in Bannock City, due west, back in the early summer of 63. She figured to earn her keep. And in this country, where a pie could sell for $5, a husband and wife needed to work together, or go bust.
$20 worth of pies, gone to dust.
She looked at the stranger, still breathing at least, and the bleeding appeared to have slowed. She remembered the shock on his gaunt face when she had told him how much a pie of hers would cost. Man had to be a greenhorn. 100-pound sack of flour cost $28 these days. And folks thought that was a blessing. A year ago, a person would have thought he had haggled his way to glory if he paid under $90 for a sack. Butter still went for $1.50 a pound. That same price could fetch you an egg, providing it wasn't as big as a goose egg. Onions went for 45 cents a pound, and when Nelson had learned how much merchants were charging for potatoes, he had hitched up a wagon, driven all the way to Fort Hall, and returned with a wagon load of spuds that he sold for $2 each.
Midas touch. Nelson still had that. Sometimes, though, that touch landed a little harder. The stranger moaned. Still wearing sleeve garters and a visor, Mr. Bagley eased his way down Jackson Street and cleared his throat before he knelt.
I'll take care of him, he said softly, and lowered his right hand toward the blood-soaked bandana.
He didn't look at Ellen, but he nodded at Nelson.
You get Ms. Ellen back home.
He slowly removed the bandana.
If and he needs a stitch or two, I got some fishing line that should fix him up.
The rag returned.
Don't worry, he won't die. Not with a head this hard.
He winked at her husband.
Hard as you buffaloed him, Nelson. I thought you'd done cleaved his head down to his gizzard.
Nelson rose, thanked the merchant, and extended his right hand toward Ellen. She let him lift her to her feet, and after another wave of nausea passed, she gave Mr. Bagley an appreciative nod.
God bless him.
Relief swept through her whole body. She could have kissed him on the streets, hair lip and all. Nelson picked up the tray she had dropped and moved to his bay gelding, which was looking bored at the intersection of Wallace Street.
I'll take care of your horse, Mr. Story,
someone called out from in front of the newspaper office on the corner. The youngster weaved between a pack mule and a farm wagon and gathered the reins.
You boarding him at Monty's place?
Nelson nodded.
Yes, at the Big Horse Corral. Thank you, bub.
My pleasure, sir. My pleasure.
Boy and horse moved down Wallace Street.
Let's go home, Ellen, Story said.
As cabins went in Virginia City, theirs was, well, a cabin. This evening it still smelled of flour and dried apples, and the winter kitchen remained a mess. As Nelson hung his gun belt on the elkhorn, she pulled out her purse and laid gold dust, nuggets, silver dollars, and even some U.S. scrip on the table.
$180, she announced. Or close to it.
He laid his hat, crown down, on the desk and moved to the table, fingering a gold nugget.
You don't have to bake pies anymore, Ellen, he said at last.
I like to,
she started. She was about to say help, but Nelson would not like to hear that, so she changed her ending.
Cook.
Yeah.
He ran the back of his hand against his face. He needed a shave.
But maybe you'd like someone to cook for you. For us, for a change.
She moved away from the table.
His right hand reached inside a coat pocket and slowly pulled out a leather pouch. He loosened the drawstring and shook out nuggets that spilled into the mixing bowl. The stones, much bigger than the ones Ellen had earned for her pies, glittered in the candlelight. Ellen's lips parted, but she found no words.
Nelson laughed. And that's not the half of it. That there, his chin jutted toward the mixing bowl, that's just from Alder Gulch. The half interest I put in with Ben Christenot's claim in Pine Grove. And it over at Oro Cash? You wouldn't believe what those are assaying at. I scarcely believe it myself.
Midas touch. In Ellen's head, her brother John's words rang like the Liberty Bell. Sweeping her into his arms, Nelson kissed her hard. Then someone knocked on the door. He cursed softly, stared at her briefly, then crossed to the door, his hand resting on the butt of a holstered revolver.
Yes,
he called.
Nelson,
came the muffled voice.
It's Ben.
The right hand slipped off the walnut butt and moved toward the door, which he pulled open slightly, glanced at Ellen, and stepped through the opening. The door remained partly open, but Ellen didn't eavesdrop. She tried to think of what Nelson had just told her.
Were they rich?
She fingered one of the nuggets, rubbing off sugar and flour. Once the door opened, Nelson stepped inside, pulled on his hat, and found the gun rig. As he buckled the belt, he looked at Ellen.
Don't wait up, he told her. And pull in the latch string.
The door closed behind him. Chapter 3. The potatoes on John Catlin's plate were cold. Same with the gravy. Even the beef. The waitress at the La Porte Dining Palace refreshed his coffee and moved on. Catlin broke the dam of mashed potatoes with his spoon, but no waterfall broke free. No flood of brown drenched his beef, for the gravy had congealed. Which didn't surprise him. For at least 15 minutes he had just stared at the food. Chair legs scraped the floor as Steve Grover sat, uninvited, holding his own cup of coffee. Sipping, Grover shook out a copy of Daily State Sentinel. Catlin looked across the small cafe. Palace was a misnomer, to see if he knew anyone else in the restaurant. He hadn't thought to look when he first sat down, but unless someone was hiding, Grover and Catlin were the only ones here. No, there was a gent with a silk hat by the table near the window that looked out onto the alley, spooning lemon cake.
How long you been here?
Catlin asked.
Just got here. Got a cup of water dyed with coffee. You were so focused on your chow, you didn't even hear me say afternoon, Captain.
Oh.
Catlin eyed his food. Grover studied the newspaper.
At $2 a year, Grover said, a man would think there'd be something worth reading.
You subscribe to an Indianapolis newspaper?
No. He turned the page. Found it on a bench outside of Marston's.
You getting a photograph or ambrotype taken?
Neither.
Grover flipped to another page.
Just walking past. He's closed on Sundays anyhow.
He peered over the top of the paper.
You ever get a likeness made of yourself?
Catlin nodded.
Indianapolis, before we marched south. Tintype. Mailed one? No. Must have been 2 to Ma and Pa in Michigan. I got 4. Must have kept 1 for myself. Don't know what I did with the other.
How much did that cost?
He shrugged.
2 bits, $4. Don't rightly recall.
Grover returned to the newspaper, went to another page, looked at Catlin again.
How do you know it was an Indianapolis newspaper?
I left it on the bench outside Wallace's grocery house.
You subscribed to the Sentinel?
No, I found it in the trash box outside of Culver's.
You buying a book or crockery?
Grover asked.
Where?
At Culver's?
No, he's closed too, it being Sunday. I just looked down by chance, saw it, picked it up.
Wonder how it got all the way up here. The paper, I mean.
Drummer, I warrant.
Most likely. Wonder how it got from Culver's to Marston's.
That's a mystery for sure. Catlin looked at his plate, sighed. You don't read the Herald?
Charlie Powell don't put nothing in his paper except advertisements for blood pills. You?
Catlin was too late trying to cover his yawn.
Excuse me. I'll pick one up now and then when I find one at the grocery or Culver's store.
How'd your winter wheat make out?
Slim. Yours?
About the same. Spring wheat was average.
Mine too.
Figure this spring'll be better.
Catlin nodded.
If we get some decent rain.
Silence.
Come to church?
Got here too late. You?
I just got here.
A month, or maybe just a minute, passed.
Well, I know why you left this on the bench. Nothing worth reading in Indianapolis, either.
There's always something worth reading, Catlin said.
What?
Sighing, Catlin took the paper, turned to the second page, and tapped at the quotation below the paper's name and the date. The Union. It must be preserved. Jackson. Grover nodded, took the paper, and slid it to the side of the table. Catlin plowed the potatoes with his fork. Preparation, he figured, for spring. If spring ever returned. Grover slurped. Catlin farmed the mashed potatoes. The gravy hardened. The waitress walked by without checking on either.
You know what I like to read in any newspaper?
Grover asked.
What?
Catlin said. Grover picked up the paper again and tapped a column on the front page.
The railroad schedules. Bellefontaine Railway.
Catlin feared his friend would start reading the whole damn table. Trains arriving from the east and the west, the expresses, plus everything else. But no. Steve Grover condensed things considerably, and even Indianapolis lacked a bevy of railroads.
The Atlantic and Great Western Railway.
You plan on taking a trip?
Where would I go?
Catlin shrugged.
Lake Michigan?
Wouldn't need to pay money for a train ticket to see that. Could march there if I had a mind to. I sure know how to march.
Catlin smiled with understanding.
You ever seen Lake Michigan?
Catlin looked up, surprised at the question and his answer.
Can't rightly say I have. You?
Grover's head shook. Another round of silence.
Funny,
Grover said.
What's that?
Lake Michigan.
Grover sipped his coffee.
The two of us. We saw so much of the South, even Washington City, and we haven't seen a big lake that's, what, 20 miles north of us? If that.
Catlin grinned.
You want to go?
Where?
Lake Michigan.
Grover shook his head.
Not in winter.
Maybe come spring.
The head shook again.
We'll be plowing.
Another taste of weak coffee.
Besides, it's just a bunch of water.
Catlin thought about tasting the meal he'd paid for, decided against it.
Ran into Mrs. Yoho at Albert's store yesterday,
Grover said.
How's she doing?
Got the catarrh.
I see.
Getting better.
There are remedies.
Grover tapped the newspaper.
Papers are full of advertisements for cures, especially in Charlie's Herald. Last time I saw a copy, anyhow.
Must be an epidemic.
You ever caught it?
Don't think so. But I don't rightly know what the catarrh is.
Me neither.
2 months passed, or maybe it was just a couple of minutes.
It's just a cold, Grover said. Something like that.
What's that?
The catarrh.
Yeah, congestion. Runs down the back of your throat.
Huh?
Catarrh.
Yeah, I know what it is.
Most people do.
Old Benash seemed to have it from Louisville to Atlanta.
Likely still has it. Where did he hail from?
Grover thought.
Union Mills?
I thought it was Unionville.
Might have been. Union something.
Or maybe Rensselaer.
They grinned, sipped coffee, which still wasn't good. Catlin wondered how his dinner would taste if he'd bothered to eat. Then again, he knew how it tasted. Hell, that's all everyone ate here, whenever they came to town to splurge on a meal, something they didn't have to cook themselves. And when they ate at home, this is the same blessed meal they'd cook.
She asked if I'd speak to the Unconditional Union girls of LaPorte, Grover said.
Who?
Mrs. Yoho.
Catlin had to reconnoiter to figure out where Mrs. Yoho came into the conversation.
Speak about what?
He asked after a moment. Grover smiled and tapped the folded newspaper.
How I preserve the Union.
Oh.
Catlin wondered if the beef might be halfway decent.
I got asked to speak once.
To the Unconditional Union girls?
Catlin shook his head.
St. Rose's Academy.
What did you say?
Nothing. I told the headmistress to ask me another time, after the wheat crop was in.
Oh, you get asked to talk a lot?
Catlin looked at his friend.
I don't get to town often.
Yeah, what brought you into town today?
Run some errands.
Not much open on a Sunday.
I know.
Is anything open in LaPorte on a Sunday?
Catlin shrugged.
The dining palace, church, livery.
What I figured. What errands did you run?
I run away from the farm.
Grover smiled.
Yeah, me too.
The bell above the door jingled. Cold air came in. Hot air came out.
See ya, hun,
the waitress told the fellow with the silk hat. The door closed. The waitress went back to reading a penny dreadful.
What did you tell her?
Catlin asked after another season came and went.
Who?
Mrs. Yoho.
Oh,
he slurped more coffee. Catlin waited.
Well?
What?
What did you tell Mrs. Yoho?
Nothing, he wiped his nose. Oh, I guess I told her to ask me next time, when I had more time.
It's December, Steve. You won't have less time than right now.
Well,
they drank. Catlin gave up on his dinner and slid the plate toward Grover.
You hungry?
Catlin asked.
You aren't going to eat this?
Catlin shook his head.
Off your feed?
Just not hungry.
My pa wouldn't let me get up from the supper table till I'd cleaned my plate.
He raised his head, suspicious.
You want me to pay for?
No, Steve. Eat. It's cold, but it's on me.
Well, I can't say I'm hungry.
But the plate was empty 3 minutes later, and Steve Grover wiped his mouth with the sleeve of his coat.
They know how to make good roast beef and mashed potatoes here. That's for sure.
It's their specialty.
Maybe it's the catarrh,
Grover said. Catlin looked up, his face blank.
What's ailing you?
Grover explained.
Nothing's ailing me, Steve, except...
What?
Catlin smiled.
Boredom.
Grover's face surprised Catlin. His old friend... Friend for something that felt like 20 years now, when it would be just 4 come spring, knew what he meant, when half the time John Catlin couldn't figure that out himself.
Remember what you said?
Grover asked.
When?
In Washington City, during the Grand Review.
Before Catlin's head shook, Grover answered his own question.
You said, Steve, we're going home at last. Remember? That's exactly what you said.
He drained the coffee with 2 final slurps and set the empty mug beside the plate.
Here we are, walking past President Abraham Lincoln, Sherman, Grant, Sheridan, ladies throwing flowers at us, swooning, men cheering. And after all we've been through, you just wanted to get home.
Catlin smiled.
All I wanted to do was get home after we first saw the elephant.
Me too, Grover said. Best time of my life, but I was too scared to know it.
Me too.
Horse apples.
Catlin looked up.
You were born to soldier, John. Captain Sabin said you took to infantry faster than crap flowed through a goose. Made 5th sergeant before I could shoulder a musket. Captain after Atlanta.
Mrs. Yoho ought to ask you to speak about...
The words trailed off. Catlin remembered. 25 years old when he had joined the fight in August of 1862. All that marching and drilling in the Indiana summer. Meeting Steve Grover. Meeting hundreds of other men.
Lake Michigan, Catlin said.
Huh?
I was just thinking. I'd never seen anything before we enlisted.
Well, Ohio.
Maybe I ought to go see Lake Michigan.
You seen Ohio, John?
I was born in Ohio. Can't say I remember much about it. Pa and Ma had the wanderlust. They're living in Michigan now. Never seen Michigan either. We sure saw a lot of country.
Grover drank coffee.
I don't think you'd want to see Lake Michigan now, John. It's colder than a witch's teat outside.
Spring, summer, and fall came and went, and here they sat, 10 minutes later, at the dining palace in La Porte. Most likely the waitress had started her 5th half-dime novel. The cook was probably on his 3rd marriage. The owner might have sold his interest and taken the Bellefontaine to anywhere.
What would you tell them?
Grover asked.
Tell who?
The Union Girls, or St. Rose's Academy, where they'd ask you again.
Oh,
Catlin shrugged. He finished his coffee.
Coffee was better in the 87th, he said. Grub was too.
That's what you'd tell them?
Who?
Mrs. Yoho, you darn fool. Charlie Powell at the La Porte Herald, the headmistress at St. Rose's, the governor, President Johnson, were he to give you a medal, your ma, your pa, anybody who asked.
Oh, no. I don't talk about it much. When I do get asked, I just shrug, say, we won the war, saved the Union, freed the slaves, if I even say that.
I'm the same.
The clock ticked. The waitress stared at them long and hard before she turned another page in some yellow-covered book.
Well, Catlin stretched. Guess it's about that time.
Yeah.
Getting late.
Yeah.
Ought to get my wagon, head back home.
Yeah.
Might come a good snow.
Maybe. Moisture would help.
They waited.
We did it, though, didn't we?
Grover said.
What's that?
Grover punched at the newspaper.
The Union. It must be preserved. We sure preserved her.
Catlin nodded. He made himself stand, otherwise they might be here till the century turned. The waitress looked their way, relief washing over her face. Catlin found his watch in his vest pocket, checked the time, sighed.
You know what I'd tell them?
A sadness filled Steve Grover's eyes.
Tell who?
The Unconditional Union Girls.
Oh, Catlin said. What?
I'd tell those ladies this. I never knew how gall darn boring Indiana was till I went off to war.
Chapter 4. When he came to, the first thing Mason Boone did was vomit. During a pause between his retches, he heard a snigger and a laugh. Once his eyes finally focused, he realized that he wasn't in the cold street and that that black-haired, dark-eyed angel had vanished. From his own stink, he knew he hadn't had any peach pie. No, the woman had been hawking apple pie. Dried apple pie. The thought of pie left him dry-heaving. Another aroma eventually reached him, and Boone lifted his eyes toward a tin cup. Past the cup, he made out yellow teeth grinning between a brown mustache and goatee.
This'll cure ya, the voice said.
Groaning, Boone lifted his head as much as he dared and took the tin cup. The liquor practically burned his eyes as he brought it to his lips. It didn't go down any better, but it stayed down, for now. The 40 rod took away the headache, though, until Boone gently fingered the pulpy knot on the top of his head. The man with the goatee splashed more rot gut into the cup, then brought up the jug to his own lips.
Another voice in the shadows said,
Looks like you got tomahawked with the Cree War Club.
Story swings it like an axe, Goatee said.
This time, when Boone lifted the cup, his stomach recoiled, and bile started climbing up his throat. He rested the cup on his knee. A horse snorted, hooves stamped. He smelled wet hay, grain, leather. Figured he had to be in a livery stable or barn.
Story?
Boone asked. Goatee nodded.
You were accosting his wife.
Boone had to think. Bits of memories came to him. He remembered the woman and the pies, but not any husband.
You don't remember?
He never saw the bastard.
Another voice, more mouse than man, whispered from the darkness.
Story ain't one to give a body no chance.
Goatee drank more homebrew. The jug found a spot on a bale. The man found a more comfortable position.
From the looks of them butternuts and brogans, or what's left of shoes, I say you fought for the South.
Boone delicately traced how big the scalp injury was. No stitches that he could detect, but he knew from experience just how hard it was to stitch a head wound. At least no one had tried to cauterize it. They had just packed it down tight with some sort of salve, or maybe mud. For all he knew, it could have been bandaged with horse apples. He ignored Goatee's comment. He had been in Montana Territory, or Idaho Territory, or whatever the damned government wanted to call it these days, long enough to realize more Yankees mind up here than Johnny Reb's.
I like a man who don't talk much, Goatee said. They call me Plumber.
Boone looked harder at the man.
So you've been here long enough to hear that name.
Goatee nodded.
I figured it's a name to be remembered. It ain't my real name. You don't need to know that. Hell, I've practically forgot it. You just call me Plumber.
Damn fool alias to use, if you was to ask me, one of the voices said. Get your neck stretched just like old Henry.
You got no imagination, Freddy,
Goatee told the mousy voice behind him.
That's why I took the sheriff's name. What are the chances two men using the same handle would get killed in the same district?
Grinning, he tapped his temple.
Brains. That's what I got. Brains.
He wet his lips.
Was you here when they stretched the sheriff's neck?
Boone's head shook. All he had heard were the tales. He didn't know what he ought to believe. About one Henry Plummer, who not only had been sheriff and simultaneously leader of an outlaw gang, until the folks around Bannock began to suspicion the lawman, persuaded a captured bandit to give up some names, and then lynched the sheriff and other brigands. That had been early, back in 64, and in Bannock. Boone hadn't reached Alder Gulch until the following fall, and he'd never even seen Bannock.
I'm gonna let folks think I'm Henry Plummer's kid brother. Put the fear of God into the Vigilance Committee. Let them worry if the sheriff's brother plans to get himself a little revenge. You savvy what I'm saying?
Boone didn't understand a thing, but at least he was out of the cold. He asked,
Was it Plummer that buffaloed me? Plummer's dead, you idiot.
Goatee turned his head, spit and swore.
What have we been talking about? I asked you if you were here when the sheriff got killed. You said no, and then you asked me,
Leave him be,
said a voice, the one more Virginia than Mouse, and not slurred as much as Goatee's.
Fella gets his brains knocked to his bowels, a 4-inch gash in his noggin, and you interrogate him like you're the professor at the post. Man ought to be dead. Hard as Story hit him.
Story hit me?
Boone said.
That's right, Plummer said. You got your head practically cleaved in two by NG Story, and that NG stands for no good. So me and the boys are gonna put Story in his place, and we figured, since it was Sandy yonder who got your head put back together.
The nod was too vague, Boone's vision still not quite adjusted to the light, whiskey and headache too determined which voice belonged to Sandy.
We figured you'd like to get a chance to get even with the damned head splitter. You game boy?
His stomach had settled. He hadn't vomited, so Boone figured he might have nodded in agreement. He reached for the 40 rod, not that he remembered doing it, but his hand held the cup. The fumes almost disintegrated his nose hairs, and he drank.
Attaboy, Reb. We'll show Story and his vigilantes just who runs Virginia City and Alder Gulch these days. Rest up, pard. Drink up. Ain't nothing gonna happen till dawn.
They given Timmy, Mikey, and Mark that long to get right with God.
The mouse squeaked.
We'll see who's meeting St. Peter first in a couple of hours,
Plummer said.
Story's got balls,
the deeper voice said. Plummer took another pull from the jug.
Yeah, but come dawn, all of Alder Gulch will find out if Story's balls are brass or paper mache.
Chapter 5. There were five of them, not including Goatee, who called himself Plummer. Not including Mason Boone, either, since Boone didn't consider himself a member of the gang, or posse, or whatever they were. His head hadn't cleared up enough to savvy much of what was happening, if he understood anything at all. Light began creeping through the open door of the barn, though Boone wouldn't call it morning. Outside, what looked like snowflakes swirled in the wind. When was the last time it snowed back home in Tyler, Texas? Boone couldn't recollect, but at least he remembered he grew up in East Texas. That meant he didn't have anemia. No, that wasn't right. Not anemia. What was it?
I know how it is, pard.
Goatee slurred words even worse now.
You come up here expecting to find the mother lode and get nothing but tailings and tail race.
The man who wanted to be mistaken for a dead thief and lawman tried to suck the last drops out of the jug. Boone felt the knot on his head. He could touch it now.
Mother lode, Goatee had said.
The fool didn't know much about Alder Gulch. There might be some lode mining going on somewhere in these hills, but all Boone had seen were placer outfits. Boone wouldn't call himself an expert, but... The man named Sandy came over with a pot of coffee, filling Boone's cup and ignoring Goateed Plummer.
About that time, Ambrose, Sandy told the boss,
which triggered Boone's memory.
Amnesia,
he said aloud, causing Sandy, Plummer, and the three others to stare in his direction. Boone almost grinned and held his cup up.
Thanks. Drink up.
Plummer, or Ambrose, or Goatee, whoever he was, pitched the empty jug into the nearest stall and tried three times before he climbed to his feet.
We got business. Time for us to save our McGee cousins. Time for us to show Virginia City who runs Alder Gulch.
He unbuttoned his coat, revealing an old horse pistol stuck inside the waistband. Plummer seemed to sober up instantly.
Cindy, you and Robin back me on the street. Donnie, I want you and that Colt's revolving carbine at the corner, and you make enough noise so the vigilance boys think there's 50 of you right behind you. Howard, you stand on the other side. When I nod, send a blast of birdshot into the sky. When those pellets start raining down, you train the barrel with the buckshot at the crowd. If they start the ball, you finish their dance. You savvy?
All but Sandy nodded. Boone's head started hurting again, so he kept still. Besides, Plummer hadn't given him any directions. Now that he could see better, Boone realized that the leader of this gang couldn't be out of his teens, and that the mustache and goatee were pasted on, like a young thespian playing Shakespeare in some chintzy troupe. Plummer said,
And you? Ironhead, you hold our horses. We ain't got that many, so we'll be riding double.
With that, the men walked outside. Boone was the last one out of the barn, and to his surprise, he found several horses tied up at hitching rails. He counted five mounts. He watched the men marching toward the main street and did some math. Three McGee boys, Plummer with the goatee, Sandy and the four others whose names he had already forgotten, and Boone himself, 10 men. Mrs. Mary Alma, back at the Tyler subscription school, would be beaming with joy, at least, if Boone's ciphering was right. Boone could figure which one wouldn't be riding double. The men didn't look back. They had already turned the corner. Mason Boone walked after them, but he left the horses in the alley. If he hadn't already figured out that Ambrose, alias Plummer with the goatee, was a damn fool, he understood that before he climbed halfway up the hill on the northwest side of town. A crowd had come out this fine, if snowy, Monday morning to watch the hangings. Not that Virginia City was as big as it had been when Boone had briefly passed through on his way to that god-awful mining camp 14 months or so back, but Boone figured at least 50 people braved the cold to watch the show. 50 against 5? Boone had already dealt himself out of this hand. Plummer with the goatee had gumption. No brains. But Boone watched those men keep right on up the hill, and it wasn't an easy hill to climb, even without snow and wind. Plummer's group didn't seem to care that the hangings weren't happening in town, but up at the paupers' cemetery. 3 wagons had brought each of the McGees up, and the teams had been unhitched, and the tongues pushed up with ropes attached and hangman's nooses ready. The McGees, already hooded with hands tied behind their backs, had been hoisted atop separate crates, and now 3 businessmen in greatcoats and mufflers began tying their legs with short ropes. Plummer with the goatee drew out the dragoon, cocked it, and the other men spread out on either side of him.
I wonder if these McGee boys know what fine fools they have for friends.
A horse's snort and a squeaking wheel interrupted Boone's thought, and he turned and stepped aside as a surrey made its way up the hill. Boone reached for his hat, only to realize he hadn't seen his hat since the previous evening. The cold wind and snow seemed to ease the pain in his head. Stop! The rig's driver obeyed. A woman leaned out. Boone's heart leaped.
Are you all right, sir?
God must have rendered him mute, but Boone nodded at the lovely woman.
I apologize for any inconvenience, any injury, the angel spoke. My husband has... Well, if you are in town tomorrow, see me. The pie will serve as payment and apology.
She vanished. The whip lashed. The surrey continued its climb. Boone followed, no longer trailing the friends of the McGees, but the fancy rig.
My word, Mrs. Story, you should not be here not to witness this.
A pale man with a thick mustache and dark hair combed back to hide his thinning locks, with the palest eyes Boone had ever seen, and a delicate English accent, hurried up to the rig. He turned his head and coughed.
And you, Professor Dimmesdale, the black-haired woman said, should not be here in this weather.
The hacking cough almost doubled the slim man over, but he straightened, glanced at his silk handkerchief, which he used to wipe his pallid lips before slipping it into the outside pocket of his gray coat.
Mr. Story will be having a Benny if he sees you, the man pleaded.
I know of his temper, and I live here. This is something I should see.
The man started to protest, but he detected Boone easing up the road. A shotgun's roar turned the attention of the weak English gentleman, Mrs. Story, the driver of the rig, Mason Boone, and everyone at the edge of the cemetery to Howard, the skinny redhead with the shotgun. He now stood next to Plummer with the goatee, after thumbing back the hammer of the barrel holding the buckshot. Pellets must have been falling harmlessly to the hilltop now, but the only sound Boone heard was the wind moaning through wagons and over remnants of shoddy crosses. Howard's shotgun pointed in the direction of the men closest to the 3 wagons that had been turned into hangman's scaffolds.
First one of you sons of bitches that even looks crossways gets killed.
Plummer with the fake mustache and goatee took center stage.
You yellow dogs ain't hanging nobody, because it'll be you who gets buried. My name's Plummer, if that means anything to you. So here's how we're playing this hand. I got me 150 men at Daylight Creek, and another 50 over yonder.
The wave seemed vague.
And if one more gunshot sounds, those boys are riding up here like Quantrill done at Lawrence.
He waved the heavy pistol.
So which one of you's got the guts to take on another plumber?
The wind stopped, as though ordained by God. A voice near the wagon said,
Come on, Ben.
A tall man wearing a black hat stepped out of the sea of bearskins, sheepskins, and dark wool. The woman by the surrey and the lunger gasped. The man with him, the one named Ben, stopped, turned, and put his hand on a holstered revolver, but didn't draw. The other man walked to the first McGee and kicked over the crate. As the man danced, twisted, and died kicking, the man moved to the second wagon. This particular McGee was pretty heavy, and the man in the wagon grabbed the tongue with both hands. Just before Nelson's story, Mason Boone had no doubt who had taken on the job of executioner, kicked over that crate. The snapping of the man's neck sounded like thunder. He didn't kick at all, just twisted on the cord. The last of the McGees started singing, sobbing, crying, and praying at the same time. Story kicked over the crate and moved down the hill as the last McGee kicked so hard his pants fell down. The man called Ben drew a pistol and put a bullet in the kid's head, then yelled, Cut the bastards down! Nelson's story stopped about 20 paces in front of the quiet plumber with the goatee and the shaking Howard with the shotgun. No one spoke. Plumber turned around slowly, lowered the pistol to his side, and moved back down the hill. No raiders swarmed up the hill from creek beds or streets. Howard laid his shotgun gently on the ground, then hurried after his leader. The other once vengeance-minded men mingled ever so discreetly with Virginia City citizens. The wind resumed. So did the flurries. The professor named Dimmesdale said,
Bloody hell. Bloody hell. Bloody hell.
And as Howard and Plummer, with the fake mustache and goatee, walked past the surrey, Mason Boone cleared his throat and said,
They're brass.
Chapter 6 Molly MacDonald was in her cups, but she wasn't drunk enough to ignore the woman's scream down by the privies, even if her comrades were.
What you stop for, Mickey?
The Bulgarian said, nodding toward the wagon yard.
You hear that?
Molly asked.
Yeah, Mickey, we heard it, said Harvey Coleman. I sound like that when I take a shit after eating at Missioner's. Come on, we're three sheets to the wind and gotta pull out of this pigsty before daybreak.
You bitch!
Came a curse in the blackness behind the privies, followed by a thud against wood.
Ain't no concern of ourn, Coleman argued.
You boys go on, Molly told them. I gotta take a piss.
Mickey, the Bulgarian said. Not our affair.
Get to the wagons,
Molly ordered.
I'm just taking a piss. Give you my word of honor.
Reaching behind her back, she withdrew the bung starter. Never had been much of a hand with revolvers. Knives either, but give her a black snake whip, and she could guide a freight wagon across the North Platte and to the banks of the wide Missouri without working up a decent sweat. 20 yards into the darkness, she stopped, turned, and glanced at the street. Coleman and the Bulgarian, true to their word, were out of sight. Now Molly felt her heart slamming against her ribcage, and the wooden handle of the weapon she'd stolen from a Leavenworth saloon felt clammy in her hands. 3 years she had been doing this, living in a man's world, like a man, chewing tobacco, drinking the worst liquor in the territories, having to sneak away to empty her bladder. But her parents hadn't found her, and unless she slipped, probably never would. Hell, they'd likely given up on ever seeing their beautiful Southern Belle again. Besides, if they saw what she had become, they'd disown her, much as she had disowned them 3 years ago. Her blonde hair had been shorn tightly. Linen kept her breasts tight beneath her coarse muslin shirt. The wind and sun had bronzed her face, and she had learned not to take a bath very often. She wore a black patch over her left eye. But had the Bulgarian or Coleman ever borrowed it, they would see right through it.
Somewhere beyond the adobe village and Fort Kearney, a coyote yipped. Molly stepped to the first privy, thankful that the Nebraska cold kept the stench down in the two-holer. Well after midnight, with just a sliver of a moon, the alley in Dobie Town remained dark. Another noise reached her ears, and she wondered why the hell she had decided to be so brave. She certainly didn't need to impress the Bulgarian or Coleman. A figure lurched around the edge of the picket structure, and Molly choked back a shriek before she swung the bung starter up. She had to swing up. Molly didn't stand much taller than 5 feet in her short-heeled boots, and the man coming at her had to be 5'8". Her blow landed solid. The man let out a yelp, fell hard to the ground, and didn't move. Knees buckling, Molly sank beside the son of a bitch she had just laid out cold. The rye almost made its way up her throat, but she choked most of it back into her gut, turned, spit the rest onto frozen sod. When her chest stopped heaving, she managed to say,
"Shit."
The man groaned. Molly brought up the bung starter and quickly dropped it.
"Shit,"
she said again, and rammed her left hand into her coat pocket, brought out the lucifers, and struck one against her thumbnail. Wind blew out the flame, so she cursed again, fingered another lucifer, and this time cupped her hands as soon as the tip flared to life. On her knees, Molly moved closer to the man.
"Son of a bitch," she said. "You're a woman."
Men didn't wear dresses. Molly laughed at the thought.
"And women don't wear trousers or chew tobacco."
She started to bring the match closer to the woman's face, saw the knot and blood the bung starter had left on her forehead, and then glimpsed something else, closer to the privy, reflecting the match's flame. Walking on her knees, she moved toward the other body on the ground and brought up the match just as it blew out. Another curse, another match, and the fire cast an eerie glow on. She whispered a series of profanities toward the corpse. Molly MacDonald might have clubbed a woman by mistake, but there was no doubt that the man with the butcher's knife stuck just below his rib cage, angling upward, buried all the way to the hilt, was none other than Brevet Major Warner Balsam, deader than President Lincoln himself. Swearing again, she shook out the match, pushed herself into a standing position, and said,
"Wait here, lady."
Then she took off down the alley, back to what passed for Dobie Town's main drag, for she remembered the mule tethered in front of the crib next to the bona fides. The jack was still there, didn't even resist when Molly loosened the reins and led the lethargic but otherwise cooperative animal a tenth of a mile to the alley, then down toward the privies. That's when the mule started braying. Must have smelled the blood, Molly figured, since an animal's sense of smell was stronger than her own, especially after all that rye she had consumed at the Jack of Diamonds.
"Stay,"
Molly told the mule, as if ordering a dog. She dropped beside the woman, still breathing, now groaning. She saw her ripped blouse, the two fingernail scratches along her neck. Easy to figure out what had happened, for Molly had seen the major at work before. Some poor wayfaring lass on the overland trail. Maybe a widow, though Molly saw no ring. Maybe anything. That Cretan Balsam deserved what he had reaped. But Molly also understood the temperament of a place like Dobie Town and of soldiers stationed at Fort Kearney. Hanging a murderess sure would break up the monotony of a Nebraska winter. Molly moved to the corpse and reached toward his blouse. Months had passed since she had touched a dead man, and that had been some poor wayfarer who got filled with arrows and scalped by Cheyennes. At least that's how Coleman figured it, and Coleman had been moving up and down this trail since the Oregon rush. She tried to avoid the dead man's eyes. Yeah, he had to be dead. Eyes hadn't moved one way or t'other since she had first spotted him. Her fingers touched the cold chain of a watch, and she ripped it up. Watch and all, though the fob broke off and fell somewhere. It didn't matter. Bringing the watch, still ticking, toward her face, she could feel its weight, maybe gold. It was hard to tell in the darkness, but it kept right on ticking. So she swung it hard against the privy door. The noise stopped.
She filled her lungs, held her breath, entered the outhouse, found the opening, and dropped the busted watch into the stinking depths. Next, she found his billfold, from which she withdrew the government scrip. These she stuffed inside her left boot top. The Remington revolver and pouch of leaden balls and percussion caps she deposited into another privy. All right, Molly could breathe now. But what about the knife? Would a thief and murderer leave a knife in the murdered victim's body? Probably not. She sat beside the dead man, gripped the freezing handle, and tugged.
Son of a bitch,
she said. Damn thing didn't budge. She started again, but out of the corner of her eye saw the mule begin to wander back toward Dobie Town's main drag.
Hold on!
She sprinted forward, grabbed the reins, and tied one to the unconscious woman's ankle. Now she had to catch her breath, but not for long, because voices sounded. Maybe from the Jack of Diamonds, but possibly closer. Men who drank eventually urinate. So do women. With everything going on now, Molly thought she might piss her britches. Another curse, and she left the blade buried inside the major and moved toward the woman. She lifted. A woman just over the 5-foot mark usually wouldn't be able to jerk the dead weight of a woman 6 or 7 inches taller up. But Molly Mickey McDonald had put on some muscle all these years. The woman's head tilted, and she puked all over Molly's coat. She called the woman an unpleasant name.
Come on, Molly said. They catch you here, both of us will be swinging in the breeze.
She tugged. At length, Molly managed to drop the upper half of the tall blonde's body over her shoulder, even managed to stand and stagger toward the borrowed mule. She never quite figured out how she got the woman draped over the pack saddle, didn't figure it would be comfortable. But that bung starter had likely sent this pretty little thing to another world for the rest of this evening. Now all Molly had to do was get the lady and the mule as far away from the privies as she could. Get her to the wagon yard, convince the Bulgarian and Coleman that this was the right thing to do. The only thing to do. The Christian thing to do. Maybe she could tell the Bulgarian that the man this damsel had stabbed to death was a Turk. The Bulgarian, for some reason or the other, didn't care too much for Turks. Turn the mule loose, get some shut-eye, see what happened outside Fort Kearney on the morrow. She tugged the reins. The mule brayed.
Your mind's gone, Coleman told her.
No, Molly countered.
The Bulgarian interrupted.
She'll old major, kill him. Kill him dead. That's what they say in Dobie Town.
Coleman added,
it's what they say at Fort Kearney, too.
Molly found the coffee, refilled her tin cup, then spit tobacco juice onto the coals.
That ain't what happened.
It's what Captain Jessup says happened, Coleman said. How do you know the major was trying to take advantage of this woman?
Because Molly didn't have a chance to make up a good lie for the Bulgarian, who added,
she not even wake up. You hit her?
Yeah, I hit her. Scared the tar out of me.
I told you not to go down that alley, Coleman reminded her.
Look here, Molly said. There's scratches on the woman's neck. Her blouse is ripped.
Could be from the major defending himself, the Bulgarian said.
We've made this haul too many times to count, she reminded her pards. You know how Balsam worked. Remember that whore from 8 months back?
Sergeant O'Brien said the major's watch was gone, and his revolver.
So it would look like the sumbitch was robbed and killed, so they'd be looking for a man, not a woman.
A man, the Bulgarian said, like us. He had a poke on him, too, Coleman said. Poke, he grinned. Poke like a sack of money or gold dust, not poke like.
The smile broadened. It might have been the best pun or joke or whatever the hell it was Coleman had come up with in 13 years west of the Missouri. Molly's eyes rolled.
Those army boys aren't going to be going after us, not back to Leavenworth. And you leave it to me, and I'll have this petticoat looking worser than me. She'll pass for a man. sure as I'm sitting here.
I don't know, the Bulgarian said.
You want to let a bunch of vigilantes lynch a pretty girl? Well, I thought I rode with men. You want to turn her over, go ahead. I've made my play. But you've been riding for this outfit a trifle longer than me. It's your call, men.
The Bulgarian studied Coleman, who turned toward Molly.
What about the major's poke?
Molly slipped her fingers inside the boot top, drew out the script, and waved it in front of her partner's eyes.
We split even? The Bulgarian inquired.
Just like always, Molly said.
Coleman's head bobbed as he reached for the paper currency. Molly let him take it, but snatched a couple of bills from his fingers and held them up.
This is for the lady. She'll need some new duds. Men's clothing.
What about her hair?
Coleman stared at the woman, still unconscious.
While I'm at the sutler's, you cut it off. Short.
The Bulgarian sighed.
A shame. Pretty golden locks.
Ain't it, though?
After stuffing the script in her trousers pocket, Molly started for Dobytown. Chapter 7.
Looky here, youngster.
The bearded man withdrew the meerschaum pipe, blew smoke toward the loft, and pointed the stem toward the stalls on the right.
What do you see there?
The wooden stem turned to the left.
Or there?
He stepped out of the barn and nodded in the general direction of the community of Summit, then gestured toward the cemetery, old mining claims, and the hills overlooking Virginia City.
Or anywhere.
Mason Boone blinked. All he had done was ask the man if he had any work needed done. Boone wasn't quite sure when he had last eaten, and homemade liquor couldn't keep a body going forever.
You know what I see,
the old man began. Boone realized he had picked the wrong place to ask for a job.
I see a big city that's missing one thing. People.
He hacked, spit, and tapped the pipe's plain bowl on a hitching rail.
Ain't just here, boy. It's all up and down the 14-mile city. Every camp from Alder to here and gone's seeing the same dad-blasted thing. Gold gets found up in Last Chance Gulch. Same old story, son. They find pay dirt on Grasshopper City, and Bannock City sprouts up overnight. But then when we find a bonanza here, in Alder Gulch, you been to Bannock lately? Know what you'd find if you done so? I'll tell you, boy, you'd find a big city without a whole lot of people. And now we got folks lighting a shuck up north to Last Chance Gulch. And that ain't a fitting name for a mining camp, boy. Last Chance. There'll be hundreds of other chances. Gold's everywhere. Hell, boy, folks here ain't just pulling out up that way. Some are galloping over yonder way to Emigrant Gulch by the Yellowstone. I've half a mind to flip a 3-cent nickel. And if she turned up with the lady's head, I'd move northeast to Emigrant Gulch. And if she showed the three columns, I'd mosey up that way to the Last Chance. And if she landed on her side, straight up, I'd move back to Bannock. Or Idaho. Or the Pikes Peak country. And if I had one iota of brains in my noggin, I'd just say to hell with it all and go back home to Springfield, Missouri. Most days, I wish I'd never left anyhow.
He sucked on the pipe, realized it was out, and shoved it into a pocket in his mackinaw. The old man stared again at Boone, sighed, and asked,
Where are you from, boy?
Texas.
You traveled all that way? For this?
Farther, Boone figured. He had deserted the 10th after Kennesaw Mountain. Still, he let his head bob a couple of times.
Well,
the big boot shuffled.
You asked to work. That says something about you. Most of the bummers just beg for enough to get a dram of beer. Man with a charitable streak could go broke. We ain't got a bad town, not yet. Still the territorial capital, though I reckon we'll see how long that lasts. I've seen better-looking gents, though you might clean up if you shaved and... Jesus, taking a bath, wind must have just shifted directions. You stink worse than goat piss.
He spit again, looked Boone up and down, and at length sighed.
I tell you what, Buster, I ain't forgotten St. Vincent de Paul. Ain't much to muck.
But you clean out the stalls, feed and grain the 3 horses I got here. But not the bay. Bay gets hay only. She don't take to grain. Probably a Kootenai pony, I don't know. Water 'em all. You do that, and I'll pay you $2.
$2. Boone could hardly believe it. 2 whole dollars for half a day's work. Then he recalled where he was and how much $2 would buy a man in an expensive place like Virginia City. That might buy him as much as a 3-cent nickel would back home in Tyler. The man kept talking.
You can sleep in the stall. No, best not sleep in a stall. Stinking the way you do, you'd drive off any business that might come my way. Sleep in the loft. Back of the loft. It's warm enough up there. I'll see if I can't find an extra saddle blanket you can use. That suit you?
Boone nodded.
You get paid in the morn.
The old man stiffened.
After I've graded your work. You do a pissant's job, you get a kick in the pants.
Boone remembered the first mine boss he worked for, and the second. All this codger had to say come morning was that the work wasn't up to his standards, now scat. But hell, it was cold outside, and at least Boone had a place to sleep for the night. Mucking stables, feeding horses, that would at least take his mind off the emptiness in his belly.
All right.
Boone held out his hand. The man stared at it, started to shake, but suddenly stepped back, raising his hand, grabbing the brim of his slouch hat, and whipping it off his head.
Mrs. Story, he said past Boone's shoulder. It's mighty nice to see you, ma'am.
Mason Boone instantly detected the aroma of pies. Turning around, he reached to remove the hat he had lost, realized his mistake, and took a step back, suddenly aware of just how ripe he was. Maybe he could take a bath in the livery without freezing to death.
I have been looking for you, she said.
He saw the pies on the tray.
Take one, she told him, smiling.
She wore a dress of cornflower blue crinoline, striped with thin black lines, beige hat, dainty gloves, a black scarf tight around her throat, and a shawl of dark blue wool. He hadn't seen a dress like that since he and some of the boys had purloined a copy of Godey's Ladies' Book and Magazine, back before Pumpkin Vine Creek, to admire the women pictured, not the latest fashions.
Please, the woman said and smiled. A gift? An apology, please?
His stomach grumbled audibly, and his face flushed with embarrassment.
It's not a handout, sir, she said. It's payment for...
Her head tilted toward his, which began to throb again.
If you like, consider it a grubstake, she said.
Boone looked, swallowed. Couldn't figure out what to do.
It's peach, she said. Not peaches from the States, but Salt Lake. Dried peaches, of course. That's about all I could find at Rockfellow's. No raspberries, no cherries, and he just sold out of currants. I will not pay $1 a pound for blackberries and detest canned fruits, especially when he's charging $22 for a case of peach airtights.
She tried again.
Please?
His trembling right hand reached out and took the nearest pie. He almost dropped it. Swallowing, he looked briefly at the young woman, nodded, and stared at what remained of his brogans.
Thank you, ma'am, he whispered.
You take care of yourself, she said. And good day to you, Mr. Brill.
Boone heard her lace-up shoes leave the boardwalk, cross the street, reach the other side of the road. After a few footsteps, her voice sang out,
Might I have your name, sir?
Across the street, the angel stared at him.
Boone, ma'am,
he answered without thinking. A whisper at first. Then he called out loud enough for her to hear.
Boone. Mason Boone.
What a charming name, Mr. Boone. A good day to you, Mr. Boone. And to you, Mr. Brill.
He watched her walk to the corner, turn onto Wallace Street. A moment later, her fine voice called out,
Pies. Dried peach pies, $5. Pies.
Pies. Fresh baked pies.
I'll be a club-footed bastard, the old man whispered.
After lifting his gaze, Boone turned toward the livery owner, who fished the pipe from his mackinaw and fumbled in his shirt pocket for a match.
Today's your lucky day, Mason Boone. $5 pie and a $2 job. You ought to try your hand at faro over at Esterhaz's layout.
He started to strike the match, stopped, stared at the pie, then at Boone's face.
You ought not ruin that pie eating it with your filthy fingers. There's a spoon in my office. Top drawer on the right-hand side. Wash it when you're finished. I'm going to the liquor emporium. Today just ain't my day.
Chapter 8.
Keep your hair on,
Professor Thomas Dimsdale yelled at the tramp printer, standing over the Degener and Weiler printing press in the back of the Montana Post office. The Irish printer muttered an oath. Your job is to set type, Patrick, and run a proof. If anything is incorrect, I shall make the necessary corrections as I read the copy. He sighed, ran his fingers through his dark hair, and shrugged at Nelson's story.
Sorry, Nelson, you were saying?
Story smiled and sipped the tea the editor had brewed.
I said I've made a fortune in my mining investments.
The editor reached for the pencil that rested over his right ear.
This isn't for you to print in the Post.
The young man's pale face seemed to drain of even more color.
We're talking businessman to businessman, friend to friend, Story told him.
As you wish.
Story set the cup on the saucer.
The Monson, Julia Farina, Farragut, Oro Cash did well. The half interest I own in Kristinat's mine over in Pine Grove did fine too.
Bully for you.
Dimsdale found the silk handkerchief in the pocket of his waistcoat and dabbed his mouth.
But the pickings get smaller every day, meaning my profits get smaller too.
The Englishman sighed.
Alas, this is a story I hear wherever I travel up or down the 14-mile city.
He straightened and spoke in alarm.
You don't mean to pull out of Last Chance Gulch, do you?
Not yet.
Story's head shook.
How's your store in Summit doing?
The professor asked.
Story let out a short laugh. When you can charge $9 for a hammer and no one tries to haggle, I'd say you're doing all right. But I came here to mine.
And you have succeeded.
Yeah, so far.
If you mean that legislation being bandied about in Washington City, Nelson, I don't think you have much to fear. Justice Hosmer left to straighten out these foolish politicians, and others are joining him, not to quash a law that would make miners bid on claims they already and rightfully own. Ridiculous, asinine, an absurdity, but to promote statehood. Imagine, Nelson, Virginia City, state capital of Montana, not territorial.
Are you smoking opium these days, Professor?
The befuddled look on the journalist and schoolteacher's face bemused Story, who chuckled. Nelson's story, everyone in the territory would say, rarely attempted a joke.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.